So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to the series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as you must be knowing that this is a series where we discuss a set of 5 questions which are related to finance and economics current affairs and can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So I hope you are ready for today's session. So before moving ahead, a little introduction about your mentor. So guys, I have done my graduation and post-graduation from Delhi University. I have pursued my MCOM from Delhi School of Economics. And after that, I have cleared JRF in Commerce as well as Management, right? So this was a brief introduction. I hope you are ready for the session. And before moving to question number one, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are a new entrant and you're watching our video for the very first time, then do not forget to subscribe to us. And you can also press this bell icon. It can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. After that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. Okay, here's your first question for today, which says, what does it refer to? So two statements given to you, you have to select the one out of these 5 which is most suitable to these two statements which is being represented by it, right? Moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option is option C. Option C means ELSS. So before moving ahead, first of all, let us learn the full form of ELSS, which is Equity Linked Savings Scheme, right? So the name tells you a lot about this scheme. So as the first word tells you that most of the corpus, most of the money invested into the scheme is invested into equity or is invested into stock market, not into safer assets like bond. Some part or a minority stake can be invested into safer assets, but most of the money, it goes into equity, right? So this proves the first statement, type of mutual fund. So this is also very important that it is a type of mutual fund scheme. So ELSS is a type of mutual fund scheme, right? That do not invest much of its assets in safer assets, but it invests most of its money into equity, right? After that, it is also called the tax savings scheme because it gets you some rebate under income tax, right? So it is suggested as a good option for those who seek to lighten their taxation burden. Okay, investors look for investment opportunities that can help them. So see, whenever an investor tries to invest into market, different investors have different set of goals. Some, and they have different level of appetite for risk. Some of them are very pro risk. They want to take risk and they want to take a chance with earning huge profits. But some investors, they try to be really safe. They don't want value of their money to erode, but they are satisfied with a lower reward, but they do not want to get into risk, right? So you can understand it as driving. Some of us like to drive really safer. Doesn't matter if it takes time to reach our goal, but we want to drive safer. We are not going to go ahead 60, right? But some of us like to go rash, drive really fast, whether it is safe or not, right? So same is the case with investors' risk appetite. After that, so different goals generate wealth. Some of them want to add more and more money to their wealth, to their investment. Some of them want regular returns, right? So these type of people, they invest into fixed income securities where they can get fixed return. It might not be very highly profitable. Or some of them want to save taxes. So ELSS is suggested as a good scheme for those investors who seek to reduce their taxation burden. So minimum of 80% goes into equity and equity related instruments. Fund invests in equity in a diversified manner across market capitalizations, themes and sectors. See, here the money, okay, it is going into equity. This is one point. But since it is a mutual fund scheme, so in first statement we learned it's a mutual fund scheme. So obviously there is going to be the benefit of diversification, because money put into mutual fund is not invested into one share or one stock or one company, but it is divided among a number of different investments. So there can be different capitalization. So it might be possible that the ELSS invest into companies of different market caps. So some can be very large companies with huge market caps, which are very safer, but some of them can be smaller companies with lesser market cap. Some, okay, going into themes. So themes means, I think we have learned about thematic investment in one of our previous sessions, where investor, they want to invest into a particular theme, like going into companies who are environment friendly or going into companies who are into cloud services, right? So this mutual fund is going to invest some of money into different themes, not particularly in one theme. After that, different sectors, some investment can be made into pharma stocks, some in automobile stocks, right? So across different sectors to provide the benefit of diversification to the client, right? No maximum tenure of investment, but there is a lock-in period of 3 years. Okay, we usually hear that there is a lock-in period, there is a lock-in period. Why do you think there is a lock-in period? There is a lock-in period so that the investor does not withdraw the investment or redeem the investment very quickly. That can be really harmful for the companies or the fund where you are investing, right? So your money is locked in for 3 years. So the managers of your money, they are assured that the money is going nowhere for 3 years, right? So there is a lock-in of this is a condition with ELSS, there is a lock-in period of 3 years. Exemption on invested amount under Section 80C of the Income Tax Act, it is up to 1,50,000, right? So this is about ELSS, right? Moving ahead to next question for today. Okay, before moving ahead to the next question, ELSS was asked by one of you in the comments, right? So I'm going to provide you with a link where you made that comment so that you can easily reach this question, right? I hope you clear your doubt and you learn about equity linked savings schemes. Moving ahead, here is your second question, which says, which of the following is correct about different types of banking, right? Different statements given to you about different types of banking. You have to select the correct option, and the correct option for this question is option A. So option A, which means universal banking can be defined as a combination of investment banking, retail banking and wholesale banking, right? So guys, this universal banking terms, this also comes from your comments, right? So I hope whoever mentioned it, you learn about it. After that, see, before learning about universal banking, let's learn about its component. Here you can clearly see in the picture that universal banking has got three components. Number first is retail banking. So retail banking, basically banking services which are provided to retail customers like you and me, basically to small investors, right? So it includes providing savings account, checking account services, overdraft services, basic loans, credit debit cards and safe deposit boxes. Basically the services which are provided to a retail investor. After that, coming to wholesale banking. Wholesale banking, it means borrowing or lending in massive amounts. Basically it goes to the larger scale where the money is either lent to governments or borrowed from governments or giant companies or pension funds. So here they cater to the needs of, usually to the needs of institutional investors or borrowers, right? So it is highly unlikely that any individual is going to be in that list because they come under retail banking. So wholesale banking basically deals with customers who deal into large sums of money. After that, coming to investment banking. So the name in itself suggests you that there is going to be some sort of investments. So the bank that provides you with asset management services like mutual funds, mergers and acquisitions, helps companies with mergers and acquisitions. Basically, if any investor is making any sort of investment and with that process the bank is helping, then it is known as to provide investment banking services. Usually there is a difference, there is a demarcation. Investment banks are different, commercial banks are different, or if there is a parent company, there are different branches. But if one bank is providing you with all these services, then it is known as a universal bank. So investment banking, it includes the services provided related to securities also, like securities trading, securities underwriting. If companies are coming up with IPOs and they need underwriters, then also universal bank can come in handy, right? So these are the three components. Moving ahead. Okay, let us learn some more things. I think we have discussed majority of the points here. Universal banking system, which provides wide variety of comprehensive financial services. Just a second. And investment services also. So retail, commercial, investment. Make sure that there is optimum utilization of resources. So these banks, they get a benefit of economies of scale because they are providing so many services that obviously there is going to be a cost optimization, and it is beneficial for the investor also because they find all the services under one roof. They do not have to go to different institutes for different services. But obviously if they are engaged into so many things, there is lack of specialization and they need to be really, really efficient so to manage all these things, all these components. So such banks offer other advantages like diversification of risks, easy marketing, offers a huge range of services under one roof. So marketing is easy for different services because they are one wholesome entity for providing different services. After that, universal banks. See, these are some disadvantages associated to society or associated to the industry. Universal banks, they can convert into monopoly because then there is no competitor left for them, or they are not leaving any stone unturned. They are not leaving any area where a rival can come and beat them, right? So they can turn into monopolies as these are larger banking institutions. So monopoly power can have potential repercussions on the banking institutions and public too. Obviously, when an organization grows really large, it becomes systemically important, and in case anything bad happens with it, there are repercussions, there are consequences for the entire industry, for the entire economy, right? So I hope you remember what happened with Lehman Brothers in 2008, right? After that, services that are offered by such banks may differ from bank to bank, and as a result of these, okay, this is also one of the downside of universal banking, that these banks, they suffer from a lot of rules and regulations because see, they are into different sectors. They are into investment banking, they are into wholesale banking, so they have to comply with rules and regulation and norms meant for all these banks, right? So universal banking. Moving ahead to the next question. Here is the third question for today, which says dash term is used to describe a product or service that is developed and distributed globally but is also adjusted to accommodate the user or consumer in a local market. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution is option E. Option E means globalization. I think this is a word which is hugely found in articles regarding globalization. When we talk about different trends that are in the global economy, whether it be globalization, be it protectionism, right? So this is one trend. So globalization, although it is not a very recent trend, but it has been in news, it has been in talks for several years. So it comprises of two terms, global plus localization. So we say or use this term, when there is a company that is obviously operating on a global level or it has presence into multiple countries, but they are also localizing their products or services in relation to needs of those particular or of customers present in that particular country, right? So I think it would be better if we discuss examples, that they are going to give you a better idea. Okay, first of all, let's talk about Netflix. No better example than this, I guess. The most recent and the company which has made, I think, a globalization, a talk of the town term, right? So talking about Netflix. So Netflix, obviously it has presence in many countries. So when it started up from one country containing shows and content related to one country. But now since it has presence in so many countries, it has to provide them with content. See, this is a very personalized industry. You're providing entertainment to your customers. Then, so in that case, the entertainment needs to be in a form that is enjoyed by customers of the customers or clients of that particular country. If they would be providing only American content, then it might not be really attractive to viewers in India or viewers in Asian countries like Japan or Korea or China, right? But they need to cater to them as well. That is why after making their presence, after making their mark, they try to rope in Indian actors or wherever they are focused, local actors of their own country, representing stories that are relatable for the viewers in that particular country, right? So coming up with local content like Sacred Games or Ghoul, right? Such content was provided to attract Indian viewers or by roping in Indian actors, right? I think this needs no introduction. So this is going global as well as local. So you make your mark, you are going into different countries, you are going global, and then you are adapting to the needs of that particular area, that particular country's customers need, right? Okay, McD, an older example. So McAloo Tikki Burger, which is very popular in India, but see, catering to the population of India, they introduce this particular product, which is more relatable, which is more suitable to the needs of Indian consumer, or which is more suitable for the palate of an Indian consumer, right? So they thought that their trademark burgers might not work here. After that, Starbucks producing milkier coffee for the Indian tongue, which is usually used to tea, which contains a lot of milk. So in this way, many companies, they try to tweak some aspects of their products, which make their products or services relatable to that particular country, right? So I hope now this term is clear to you. Okay, some more discussion about localization. Combination of words globalization and localization. Term is used to describe a product or service developed and distributed globally but is adjusted to needs of users in local market. Often localization campaigns involve culturally friendly media and ad campaigns to encourage the acceptance of foreign products among a local audience. See, for this they need faces or they need minds which know that where to strike or which are aware of the needs of that particular country's customers or that particular market's customers. That is why roping in local actors or providing local stories, or first of all, this might be a secondary thing, but first of all, they need employees from that particular market who can understand the market and then try to take some actions, then try to maintain media friendly campaigns. So because see, one thing which might be acceptable in America might not be acceptable here in India. So they need to focus on that. They cannot offend the views or values of their customers. After that, localization works for companies with centralized authority structures. So this is an important point, that the authority needs to be centralized. Someone or one head, one manager based in America cannot take decisions for Indian market or cannot take decisions for Korean or Japanese market, because Asians are really different in their value system as compared to their Western counterparts. That is why for India, there has to be someone Indian who takes the decisions. So process can be expensive. Obviously, this is one drawback, that this process can be really expensive because you need to modify your product whenever you enter a new market. And resource intensive, but it often pays off for the companies that practice it. I think this whole controversy regarding Radhika Apte gave Netflix a huge publicity in India, right? So they can pay off in many terms, or many a times this money spent on localizing your product can pay that company off in terms of marketing, in terms of seeking publicity also, which might not be quantified, but obviously it benefits the company in long run. It helps the company to seek a place in the minds and heart of the customers, right? Moving ahead to the next question. Okay, question number 4 here. It says, in her morning online class, one of Ridhima's teachers told the students that Chinese government is talking about a model in which they would try to boost internal and external economic activity. Now she seems to forget the name of that strategy. Could you guess it? So this has been in news. Sorry. This particular strategy, the name is very much you can easily find them in newspapers and articles regarding international trade, articles regarding Chinese policies, right? So let's see what the correct option is. And the correct option is option D. Option D means dual circulation. So this is the name of the strategy, dual circulation strategy, which China thinks, to which China is planning to follow. Let us learn some things about this strategy. Okay, Chinese President Xi Jinping set markets abuzz in May by raising the idea of a dual circulation economy. So I think the name tells you that it involves some sort of, it involves two entities or two markets. Basically, there is relevance of the number two somehow, right? So this particular strategy, China is thinking to focus on two aspects here, the internal market as well as the external market. So internal market means they are thinking to boost production and demand in their local markets. Basically, obviously we have an image of China in our minds that whenever we talk about China, we say that okay, their economy is based on exports, whatever they produce, they export. But here they are saying that we need to run our domestic economy also, or we need to give a push to demand generation also, so that our consumers in China also, they buy the products, which is going to circulate the money inside the country, right? So boosting production and demand both within the country, after that to moving to the external part, which simply means raising foreign investment or focusing on a strategy of exports. I think China is obviously an expert over this matter already. They are champions of this export-based strategy. So here they are focusing on the external aspects. Basically, from some time, a negative sentiment has been growing against China because of the US trade war, and after that, obviously because of the spread of coronavirus, COVID-19 pandemic. So it has turned many countries against China, or at least planted a negative view of China in many countries. So that should not affect its trade. That is why they are thinking of going for this dual circulation strategy. And also, every country was affected by the outbreak of pandemic. Every country faced huge economic losses. So this is also a recovery strategy, recovery tool, so that they can generate demand, right? And one more thing is here. See, when China got into the trade war with US, it realized that it is dependent upon the technology of USA. So see, China might be a champion of export, but usually they do not get into very very advanced products or very high-tech products, high-technology products. They are usually catering on the low-skill manufacturing, right? So cheap labor was one of the basic factor which attracted so many international companies towards producing in China, right? So after US-China trade war, they realize that they are dependent upon US technology. And just as India is focusing on being Atmanirbhar, being self-reliant, China thinks that it should innovate within the country so that they are not dependent upon technology from other countries. So in case anything bad happens or relations go bad with some country, they should not be facing huge losses, right? So this is the dual circulation strategy. Aims to reduce China's dependence on foreign markets, has been touted as a viable strategy to build up resilience to external shocks, especially, so here shock One shock is obviously the US-China trade war. I think we read in newspapers on a regular basis Trump imposing tariff on this or China retaliating like this, right? So to protect their economy from all these shocks, especially during post-pandemic times and ongoing US-China tensions. So we never know that how long these tensions carry on. So here is your fifth question for today, which says, select the incorrect statement about short selling. And the correct option for this question is option B. Option B means 1 and 4 are the incorrect statements. So 1 is not correct, 4 is not correct, 2 and 3 are correct statements, right? So first of all, let us understand what is the meaning of short selling. This question was asked by Shivani in the comments. I hope Shivani, you clear your doubts. So guys, okay, talking about short selling. So there are two types of investors in market. One who thinks that the price is going to go up, that is called a bullish investor, and one who thinks that the prices are going to go down, the bearish investor, right? So on one security, when these two investors meet, they deal, right? For example, there is share price of a share. Let's say there's a company called A Limited, the share price is at 100, and there is one investor who thinks the price is going to go up to 150, and there is another investor who thinks that the price is going to go down to 50, right? So a bull meets a bear. Sorry. Now see, talking about now this bull investor, it is easy for him to make the profit. He can buy the shares at 100, which is the current price, and then when it gets to 150, he or she can sell that share and make a profit of rupees 50 on one share. Now what should this bear investor do? This bear investor can indulge into a process which is called short selling or shorting the shares, which means you sell a share which you think the price is going to go down, and after that, when the prices actually fall after some period of time, then you buy them at those fallen prices and complete your position, right? So let's say there is one investor who is bear, who thinks that the price is going to go down to 50. Now this investor, see, Shivani was asking that how can you sell a commodity that you do not own? Okay, valid point. But see, here we are not actually selling, but we are entering into an agreement. We are just doing an agreement. So the X investor, the bear investor, and the Y investor, the bull investor. So X says to Y that, okay, let me sell these shares to you now. Because obviously, if X wants to make profit, he would have to sell at 100, which he thinks is the high price because shares are going to fall. Whereas Y is thinking that 100 is the low price because share is going to rise, right? So X tells Y that let me sell you this share at 100 currently, but I'm not going to make the delivery now. I'm going to make it after 3 months, right? So let's say Y also thinks that after 3 months, the price is going to be 150. So Y is like, okay, I'm fine. After 3 months, when the price rises, I will take the delivery of share and then sell it and make a profit of 50, right? Now this bear investor, X investor, smart one, what he does is he enters into an agreement at 100, and let's say after 3 months, X was right and Y was not right. So after 3 months, X buys the share at 50 and then delivers the share to Y and make a profit of 50 in between, right? So an investor can sell a share or a commodity that he thinks is going to fall in price because he is just entering into an agreement, not actually delivering the product. He can deliver the commodity when the prices have actually fallen by buying them at low prices, right? This is the concept of short selling. Now let us come to the statements. The statements, they say that short selling is used only for speculation purposes. Not valid, because obviously they are used for speculation purposes by traders, but they are also used for hedging purposes, right? What is the purpose of what is the meaning of hedging? To safeguard your some of your other transactions. So hedging is just like protecting your investments from getting bad or from losses, right? So many mutual funds, they hedge their investments by this process or safeguard. So you can use the word safeguard. They safeguard their investment by hedging. So not only for speculation purposes, right? Short sellers bet on profit from a drop in securities price, correct statement. After that, to close a short position, trader has to buy the share back on the market. See, because when X had to close the transaction or had to deliver the goods to Y, then he had to buy the shares at the fallen price, which is 50, right? So to close a short position, trader buys the shares because he had already sold these shares when the prices were high, right? So this is the correct statement. I hope now you're clear about the question. Some more information about short selling. Investment strategy or trading strategy speculates a decline in the stock or other security prices. Traders may use short selling as speculation, whereas investors use it to safeguard their investments as hedge against the downside risk of a long position in the same security or a related one. So if they are having an opposite position in a related security, then they can have a short position here to match up the investments or to safeguard the investments. In short selling, position is opened by borrowing of stock or other asset that the investor believes will decrease in price in value by a set date or future, the expiration date. Okay. So guys, see, we took a simple example. In reality, X, who is the bear trader, trades with Y, who is a bull. Now, here in our example, X told Y to wait for 3 months, right? What if Y is not willing to wait for 3 months? Y says, okay, I need the delivery now. Then X can do one thing. He can borrow the stock from someone, from a broker, and then deliver them to Y, and then deal with the broker that, okay, I'll cover this up after 3 months, right? So in beginning, the bear one, the short seller, borrows the stock so that he can make a deal or he can sell that particular stock, right? Investor then sells these borrowed shares to buyers willing to pay the market price. Before the borrowed shares must be returned, trader is betting that the prices will continue. Now this trader is betting that before he has to return the shares to broker, then till then prices would have been reduced, right? So risk of loss on a short sale is theoretically unlimited since the price of any asset can climb to infinity. But what if the expectation of the bull trader goes correct and the prices, instead of falling to 50, they rise to 150? In that case, the bear investor or the short seller makes loss if the prices rise, right? And they can rise, there is no limit on their rise. They can rise as much as they want to. So there is no limit to the loss that this short seller can have. Because, okay, here we are talking about 150. It might be possible that the share price, it reaches to 250 after 3 months. Or it reaches to 500 after 3 months. The share which was currently 100. So at that time, X would have to buy the shares at 500 to square off the position. Right? So there is no limit to loss. You see how much loss is he making? 400 per share, which is too much. Right, so it can go to 1000 as well, it can go to 2000 as well, right? So there is no limit on the loss of short seller. So if you have watched or you're watching 1992 Scam, which tells the story of Harshad Mehta, these concepts are visible to you in that, how they take place in the stock market. They can give you a good idea, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then do not forget to give us a thumbs up, because I'll be back in next session with some more questions. And before ending the session, I would like to take some doubts. Okay, there was one doubt by Varun Dengale. He was asking, what is cutoff yield bond? See, Varun, whenever bonds are being issued, so there is one issuer who issues the bonds. And the buyers who are willing to buy it. The buyers, let's say they are bidding that what interest rate or what yield they want at this bond, right? So the buyers are bidding. So this process, so there has to be one price at which the issuer and the buyer, they agree that okay, issuer is going to provide this much of yield on bond to the buyer. So let's say they decide X percent, right? So this X percent is the cutoff at which decided. So all the buyers who bid below it, the issuer is going to accept them. But if they bid more than that, then the issuer is not going to accept them, or they are not going to issue securities to those buyers bidding for too much high yield, right? So that cutoff point is the cutoff bond yield. This was recently visible when RBI issued some bonds, and investors in the market, they were bidding for a higher yield because they were uncertain times and due to the news of inflation rising, right? So they wanted more compensation for their investment, whereas RBI was not willing to provide that much of yield. So underwriters had to come and buy the bonds issued by RBI. So this was just recently. And also we discussed book building process in one of the sessions, where we discussed, so book building process, the bidding process is somewhat similar to what we are talking here, right? After that, there was a doubt of Pooja. Pooja was asking that, we talked about how the prices are rising in the stock market, but that same movement is not visible in the business activity in the economy, right? So Pooja is asking, is that a signal of creation of asset bubble? So it might be, it might not be. That depends that whether that money that is going into stock market gets into some productive use or not. See, creation of asset bubble, till the investors expect that everything is fine in stock market, everything goes correctly, everything goes fine. But when there is some bad news, then the market falls or crashes, right? So we cannot estimate the creation of asset bubble now. That depends upon the usage of this money which is going into stock market. If it is used by companies in some good projects, they generate employment, they expand, then obviously it is not going to create a bubble. But if it is just speculation or rigging or just putting money to raise these share prices, then it might lead to one, right? So guys, these were the two doubts that I took today. So this is it, and I'll see you in the next session. So till then, take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and thank you for being here.